So here we are now, a week after all of us have hopefully filed our taxes, Amy, and the world now can move forward into coping with the rest of our lives, the pandemic, and making a living. And every year, I have you guys on to talk about the tax system around Tax Day, which, of course, is usually in April, and this time was in July. And obviously, we can talk about the unfairness of the tax system, the fact that it's not progressive enough, which seems to me to be this refrain every single year, and especially with Trump tax cuts, then if you go back to the George W. Bush tax cuts and so on. But I wanted to start and focus our conversation on something different, and that is the way in which over a number of years, the IRS has been hobbled in its ability to do its job to essentially collect taxes. And I wonder if in the macro way, the first thing we want to address is in some way your challenge as an advocate for the proper way in which we should tax people and collecting taxes is, it's number one, it's a little arcane, right? Except for you and I who love to talk about this. And then, as you point out, as your colleagues pointed out in some of the documents and information that you produced in light of this new report from the Congressional Budget Office about the IRS funding, you say that lawmakers' anti-government IRS funding cut zeal has actually increased the deficit. So riff on that for a minute or two.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, don't call me wonk.
I don't mind that. I consider that to be a compliment.
All right. Well, then thank you. Actually, it is a compliment, right? Because this stuff really, really matters. And that's why we work on it every day, right? There's a lot of talk right now about injustice. But, you know, one of the biggest injustices is, are we raising enough to pay for the kind of society that Americans deserve and to pay for the things that all of our communities need? And the answer to that is resoundingly no. But one of the reasons is what you're talking about, which is that there's been this sort of systemic assault on the Internal Revenue Service's ability to just collect taxes. And so we've been cutting their budget, I believe by 20%, and that has resulted in a plunge in the number of specialists who are available to do these audits or any other kind of inquiries. And that means that people aren't paying their taxes, and companies, more importantly, big corporations aren't paying their taxes, and wealthy people aren't paying their taxes. And that means less revenue. So the irony is, we could pay a little more into the IRS budget and we'd actually end up with more money overall.
And the sad thing, just to focus on the propaganda, is obviously you hear a lot of the right wingers yelling and screaming about the IRS and the injustice. But I often feel like even among, I don't know about progressives, but beyond just the real wingers, the right wingers, the people who hate the IRS, who hate government, I just think that there seems to be not support for the IRS because people don't sense that their taxes are going to good things. I mean, when they don't focus on it, right? There's a lot of, oh my God, I have to pay my taxes. I consider it my duty and I don't actually mind paying taxes. I would rather they not go to the Pentagon. I would rather they go to other services, but that's the world we live in today. But I wonder, just to carry this point a little further, that the IRS in fact suffers from this image that they don't have a lot of advocates.
Yeah, well, absolutely. And I think there's been a real discussion in recent years, and I think about it a lot, right? I am critical of a lot of the things that the public sector does. But the fact is, if we want our kids to be educated, if we want healthcare to be provided, if we want clean water, if we want meat to be inspected before it gets sent to our plates, you know, then we need a strong public sector. And the only way to get that is to have adequate and fair revenue raised from the people most able to pay it and the corporations that are profiting the most from everything that the public sector offers and enables them to thrive. And so we've got to have reasonable revenue collected, and it's got to be collected fairly. And I think to the point that you kind of raised at the beginning of this session, if the IRS is not well-funded to actually enforce the tax code, it's kind of this negative downward cycle because they don't collect enough, number one, and so then they have less money to do the things that we all need them to do. But then number two, it feeds into a perception that other people aren't paying taxes, so why should I care about paying taxes? And the fact is, what we really have is most people want to, you know, nobody, maybe people don't love paying taxes, but most people follow the rules and pay their taxes the way they should. Most working people don't really have much of a choice because their taxes are deducted from their paychecks. And so we really need firm enforcement, just like any other area of public policy, right? We need the rules to be followed so that they're the same for everyone, so that it's fair and so that people feel comfortable with the rules as they're being enforced.
And to your point, it's a circular problem because when Amazon pays zero in taxes, and you've got Amazon run and owned by the richest human being on the planet, Jeff Bezos, and they're paying zero. And then that average person who faces a tax deadline, who's making an average income, says, well, wait a minute, Amazon's not paying any taxes. Why should I pay taxes? And that's where I think the anger begins to build on itself, because people hear the news and they absorb it and they basically feel like, and they're right, the system's not fair.
Right. And so we've done previous research that showed that 91 profitable Fortune 500 companies didn't pay anything in taxes in the most recent year that we examined. And that's, you know, that's just not okay. But the fact is that the companies need a strong public sector, and certainly people and communities need a strong public sector, because like, look at the pandemic that we're in right now, right? We have a problem where because of our inability, because of our refusal to provide health care to much of our population, because of our insistence that people should sort of be in a deeper level of poverty than really is reasonable for the wealthiest country on earth, and because of this inadequate health infrastructure, this underfunding of pandemic preparedness, underfunding of vaccine research, we're in a position right now where actually a bunch of companies are suffering. And certainly a lot of communities are suffering, and low-income and working families are suffering disproportionately. So it really kind of gets right back to the core point, which is like, if we don't have a well-funded public sector, and if the people who make the most and benefit the most from our public sector don't pay into it, then we're not going to be able to deliver the kind of society that works for all of us, including them.
So I'm going to get wonky. I don't mind wearing that label and talk about a couple of numbers here, because I think we should get very concrete with people. In a press statement that Bernie Sanders released when the CBO study that I just mentioned, the Congressional Budget Office study that looked at the IRS funding, Bernie released a statement, and in it he says that partly because of the cuts in the IRS, and now I'm quoting from his statement, the IRS examination rate for the largest corporations, those with $20 billion or more in assets, dropped by about half from 2010 to 2018. And then the second sentence in his statement, the wealthiest taxpayers with more than $1 million in income saw their audit rate cut by 63% during the same time period. And so this is the reverse motto that Willie Sutton used to say about when he was asked about why did he rob banks, he would say, well, that's where the money is. Here, you've got the opposite, that the IRS, because of the cuts in its examination ability, its power of enforcement, is not going after the folks who have the money.
Right. And it's kind of crazy because the Trump administration slashed corporate taxes, right? And yet, you think that you slash the rates and then you say, all right, but we're really going to enforce what we have. But in fact, they slash the rates and then they let evasion increase. And so that results in a much lower level of revenue for the IRS. And so they actually found that if they would just increase the revenue to the IRS, the allotment, the government allotment to the IRS, by $40 billion, they would get $61 billion more. So they'd get $100 billion more. It would be a net profit for the public sector. And it would be a virtuous cycle. So exactly the opposite of what we were talking about before. People and big corporations and companies would say to themselves, wait a minute, you know, they're stepping up enforcement. We ought to comply. We ought to comply with tax rates. And it would be a virtuous cycle where, you know, the audits would bring in the revenue that was needed. But there would also be more compliance and it would become less of a problem. So, you know, you can't help but feel that this administration really likes the idea of sort of undermining government and undermining the IRS by making them less able to enforce taxes, even as they're slashing taxes, particularly for the wealthy and corporations.
Now, I want to be clear, though, since this cuts, this has happened from 2010 to 2018, I'm happy to blame the Trump administration, but this clearly happened also under the Obama administration. So there must have been cooperation, collaboration by both parties to cut the IRS.
You know, I think what we have is this sort of, and actually I think we're in a good moment now, but I think what we have had over the last 20, 30 years in the United States is a basic devaluing of what the public sector delivers in so many ways. Mm. And that manifested itself in cutting taxes. It manifested itself in reducing enforcement. It manifested itself in, you know, Bill Clinton ending, quote unquote, ending welfare as we know it. It manifested itself in a whole bunch of ways where politicians, I think, from across the political spectrum, or at least from the center right to the right, were willing to kind of undermine government and devalue the things that the government could deliver. And what I think makes me kind of hopeful right now, Jonathan, is I just think that we've had a different kind of conversation in 2019 and in 2020, where in 2019 we had, you know, a really broad field of Democratic candidates willing to say, hey, look, this is what the public sector delivers, and this government is not working for us. And then this pandemic hit, the extreme racial inequities became more apparent, at least to some people who weren't paying as much attention before. The loss of manufacturing jobs kind of became clearer. And the way that regular people were disproportionately hurt by both this pandemic and this economic crisis became really, really clear. And so suddenly now, you know, headlines are about the fact that essential workers can't get the personal protective equipment that they need. Headlines are about the fact that we've had an enormous plunge in health insurance coverage over mm-hmm. the course of this pandemic. And so I think the conversation is actually shifting in some really exciting and important ways that are gonna turn this around, where we're gonna recognize that actually we've gotta collect enough revenue from those most able to pay, because we've gotta deliver so that we can have a society that functions.
Right, and let's be clear that when we're talking about the hobbling of the IRS and the ability, if you just increase their enforcement, to bring in like $63 billion more, that's in some way a small amount compared to what is being shoveled to corporations and the richest people under the tax cuts that were pushed through by the Trump administration, supported by basically every Republican in Congress. And so that's where the big money is. But of course, enforcement matters. Now, you touched on something which opened my eyes, something that I did not realize, and your colleagues at ITP noted this on your website, and that's the racial inequities that happen in terms of tax enforcement. And what really opened my eyes, I'm going to read from this. In the fall of 2019, the IRS admitted, and this is from a document that you have on your website, that it audits low-income people at a higher rate than affluent families because, quote unquote, it's easier. In other words, lower income people, and this is certainly true when you go both in terms of class and race, they don't have the resources to fight the IRS, whereas rich people and corporations, as you well know, they can create all these tax shelters, they can take all sorts of measures to evade taxes, and they have legions, they have armies of lawyers, tax lawyers, experts to fight the IRS. So it sounds like what the IRS did is it basically hoisted the flag of white surrender when it comes to rich people and corporations, and says, let's go after the poor people and people of color.
Right. Yeah, it's really problematic. And the CBO study found sort of slightly different numbers on that. But the point is clear, right? Which is like, why are we spending money auditing someone who qualifies for the earned income tax credit? That's something that low-income working families who actually don't make enough to meet their basic needs, despite the fact that they're working. You know, why are we auditing that mom with two kids who's barely getting by? And why are we not auditing Netflix or Amazon or a really wealthy individual? And it clearly has racial implications, because the top 1% and the heads of large corporations are almost entirely white. And, you know, we have a disproportionate share of people of color who are working class or in poverty. And so anytime that we shift any kind of enforcement or any kind of negative consequence onto lower income families and away from wealthier families and wealthier corporations, we end up with really bad racial implications. And you add that to everything else that's going on in 2020, it's a recipe for a really problematic society that really isn't like fulfilling our ideals, what we were supposed to do in America.
And then one of the other pieces of important work that you have on your website right now is looking actually at the tax rates, the effective tax rates, and what's happening. You do that every year around this time. You analyze what the effect, especially of the Trump tax cuts were. And not surprisingly, again, the rich are getting away with it, right? The top 1% pay, relatively speaking, much less than poorer people. And that has a lot to do with the burden of local and state taxes that people have as a combination. So talk for a minute or two about that.
Yeah, so if people go to the Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy, that's ITEP.org, ITEP, that's my organization, you'll find our report, which is called Who Pays Taxes in America. It was written by two of my colleagues, Steve Womhoff and Matt Gardner, who I know are frequent guests on this show. And you know, they found that our tax code overall, including federal and state, is only very slightly progressive. And then if you only look at state and local, as you pointed out, then it's not progressive at all, because states and local governments rely disproportionately on sales taxes, which, you know, if you make $30,000 a year, you spend most of what you earn if you support a family. But if you make $200,000 a year or $1 million a year, you don't spend most of what you earn. You sock a lot of it away. So if you rely more heavily on sales taxes, it disproportionately affects the middle class, working class, and low income families. So the state and local tax systems are regressive. If you count all taxes across the board, it's ever so slightly progressive, but nothing like what the rates would reflect because of exactly what we're talking about, that wealthy people and corporations figure out ways to get exemptions, to get out of paying taxes. In fact, corporations get out of paying taxes in part by shifting jobs offshore. So it's really, really problematic. And, you know, there's just a lot that we could actually do about this. There are a lot of basic changes we could make in our tax code, some of which are just going back to the tax code that we had under Obama, some of which are going beyond that, that would bring in more revenue and make it more fair and make sure that higher income people pay more, which is right, because they get more.
You know, what's hilarious is I remember going back to the Bill Clinton years, which now seems like really ancient history, and then to the Obama years. And when they talked about raising taxes, I thought that's not even enough. And that's the problem about the debate. It's been narrowed so much that you've got the Republican right wing, let's destroy government approach, which is corporations and rich people basically should not pay any taxes, and we should get rid of the estate tax, and oh, these poor people shouldn't be paying the estate tax and all that nonsense. And then you have Democrats come in and they say, okay, well, we'll raise the rates a little bit higher, which to me never are enough, and that our tax system has a lot of movement. If you also look back at what the tax rates were back in the 1960s or 1970s, when we were building interstate highways, you know, you were building infrastructure, you're doing things in the country, you were enhancing Medicare, et cetera, et cetera. And so the debate has been so narrowed so that even when you have the prospect of a Democratic administration coming in, it seems to me that all they are going to do is undo the worst, but not stretch as far as we could.
Yeah, well, I'm going to push back on you there, because I don't think you give yourself
good.
I don't think you give yourself and other progressive commentators enough credit, right? Like, I think we've really expanded the debate in the last couple of years. I think the fact that some of the things that are on the table right now are incredibly exciting. And I think that that you and others like you deserve a lot of credit for that, right? Like, so a wealth tax is on the table, right? We've never had this kind of a wealth tax. But Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders and most Americans think it's a good idea that, you know, that when we look at the incredible wealth disparity that we have in this country, that it makes sense that, let's say, the top 0.1%, right? Maybe we ought to tax their wealth. And that would raise a lot of money. I think there's an increasing recognition that in making it easier for corporations to shift jobs overseas and actually get a tax benefit for that, that doesn't make sense. And I think that Americans can understand that and get behind a fix to that. And then if you look at some of the proposals that are being put forth by Vice President Biden, you know, some of them really would enrich our communities, would energize our communities, would solve long-standing climate problems. You know, he recently put forth a climate plan that would employ people. He put it forth in such a way that it would employ people disproportionately in communities that have been excluded from good jobs. Let's hope that some of those jobs would be unionized so that people would have some ability to bargain for fair wages in those positions. And that's going to cost money. And I think that there's a recognition now that if we are going to have the kind of America that we need, that can confront the kinds of problems that are coming up, which is climate change, and the kinds of problems that are here now, which is this pandemic, we're going to need to spend some money and really reinforce our systems. And as you said, you know, that's something we had no trouble doing in the middle of the 20th century. We said, look, we've got a society that's not all that well educated, that not everybody has a high school degree or a college degree. Let's put some money into that. And we did. And, you know, we became the most educated country on the planet at the time. At the time, as you said, we didn't have the kind of physical infrastructure, railroads and highways. We spent some money on that and we got it. And that was what enabled a lot of current corporations that have thrived to do so. And so I think we've got to do that going forward.
And by the way, the interstate highway that we are so familiar with, the I-10, I-80, it's called, generally speaking, the Eisenhower Interstate Highway System, because it was put in place and built by then the president, Republican president, Dwight Eisenhower. So, okay, you're optimistic. That's really good. I can't wait to talk to you in, say, March or April of 2021, assuming there's a Biden administration, and I'm going to wager with you that we progressives are going to be fighting them to follow through with what they've promised today.
Well, absolutely. And I, you know, actually you raise a really good point, because that's how everything good has gotten done in this country, right? It's not like somebody benevolent comes in and just decides to wave a magic wand. Policy is highly contested in this country. You're always going to have corporations pushing to lower their tax rates. You're always going to have some wealthy billionaires pushing to lower their tax rates, even as some are saying, hey, tax us more. And you're always going to have people who benefit from the racism and classism and lack of environmental enforcement that enriches them. But the only way that we've ever gotten good policy, from FDR to Johnson to Obama, and everyone in between, is when fair-minded progressives stand up and say, you know what, we got to invest in our communities. You know what, this racial inequity is not permissible. You know what, it's not reasonable that working class people no longer get their share of economic growth. Hmm. We got to push them to do the right thing.
I love your energy and your brains and your knowledge and your passion. And I'm sure you're going to be on the program many, many times, not just in 2021, but before. Thanks for being on the show, Amy.
Great talking to you. Take care.